What I'm talking about is peace is a person. Peace is a person. And I want us to look at it. If you will bear with me and stay with me, I think you're going to be ready for the days in front of you. And again, I literally mean the days in front of you and the days that are actually right here in front of us. In Isaiah 9, picking up with verse 6 and 7a, it says this, "For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, the Prince of Peace." We always read this at Christmas. And the Prince of Peace. "There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace." There be no end. Now he's talking, you know, remember the Bible is not written to the world per se. You know, it's written to his people. And so the Lord wants us to walk in peace. And I can tell you, I know beyond any shadow of a doubt that this morning I'm talking to the right folks because I've been talking to me. And I know there are people here who are not, do not have a rest about you. You're not peaceful. You have a churning in you. You feel torn up. You feel, what am I going to do? You're just a nervous wreck. And life is not real easy. And yet you're just being pulled in many directions. I know that's happening. But we've got to learn to live and to be steady in a storm. Because there is a storm not only on the horizon, there is a storm now. It's not a matter of, we're in the beginning of what could be a tsunami. but we're in it. It has started. So I've come to give you things so you will not lose hope. To give you things that you can rise above it. Get in despair. To get it so that you can be an absolute witness for whomever you are around, because that is the intent. Now, there's a scripture that we all know. That's Isaiah 26:3. And it says, in the Living Bible, it says, "You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you." That is the key. You cannot be in peace unless we have put our eyes on Jesus and are fixed on Jesus. Now, as we were talking about this, I'll remind you that on a whole, and I praise God, this is what the Lord said, on a whole, that we know the Lord here in this church, we know Him as Savior. On the whole, we know Him as Healer. On the whole, we know Him as Deliverer. And on a whole, we know Him as Lord. But we don't know Him as the indwelling Prince of Peace. And yet in the days that we are living in and where we are, it is of utmost importance. So the Lord wants us to understand His personality. God's personality is peace. He's the Prince of Peace. It's a person. That's who He is. God is love. God is peace. He is peace. And so He wants you and I to walk, really, in part of His characteristics, of traits of who He is, and yet understand His personality. And so as you and I are full of Him, we are to exhibit those characteristics and that personality. He says that He gives us His peace. In John 14:27, He says, "I give you My peace continuously," is what He actually says. In all honesty, peace can be practiced. You can practice peace. Now, you don't want to wait to practice when you need it. You need to practice ahead of time. You need to practice ahead of time. And it will grow if you practice it. It will grow. You just need to practice it when you don't need it. Because the enemy is going to come. He doesn't want you in peace, because if you're in peace, it shakes him up. He doesn't know what to do with somebody who's in peace. He loves basket cases. He ships them all over the world. He loves it, because when you're a basket case, you're just a fruit. You are fruity. We've all been there, haven't we? We've all been there. But we are no value to God there. Or anybody else, you're right. Or anybody else. All of us have the ability to hear the voice of God. Another nugget. It was given to you when you were born again. You can hear I don't even hear the voice. I used to say that all the time. But you can hear the voice of God. Now, you and him can't talk at the same time. That was always my problem, you know. But you can't talk at the same time. You know, you have to even practice to hear the voice of God. And guess what it takes? Shutting up. Being quiet. Well, I tried that. I was quiet for 2 minutes. You know? No. No. Because you will begin to talk to you. And you've got to decide who's who. And you've got to learn the voice of God. But the issue is you have the ability. God gave you that ability when you were born again. Now, that's a nugget. There's no one in here that does not have the ability to hear God's voice. No one. Many of you sit around, I don't know if I've ever heard it. Well, that's not God's fault. That's what I'm trying to say to you. That's not God's fault. I thought that myself, and guess what? I was wrong. That's not so. And peace will stabilize you and steady you. And the devil gets so upset when you take Jesus as the Prince of Peace. He can't stand it. Now, in Hebrews 4, and I'm not going to read it. You actually need to read Hebrews 3 and Hebrews 4 to really understand the peace and the rest, what God has for you, and how your faith brings it about. Now, you know this as well as I do. You can see on somebody, you can see when they're in peace and when they're not. You can see somebody who loves the Lord and somebody who's overwhelmed and not even involved in what's going on. I mean, all you got to do is just look out over the congregation, you know. You can even see whether you're here. Your body's here, I know. But you'd be amazed how much you can see your mind going downtown or wherever it's going, and God bless you. Some of you need to really get it back, glory to God. So you make it your point, I'm going to be in peace. Because when you're not in peace, you become a person that's not fun to be around. Well, what you do is your not being in peace makes everybody else have a nervous breakdown. Have you ever noticed it? Certain people, when you get around them, they bring a calmness to you. Certain other people, you think, dear God, I'm about to, oof. You know, you end up being, your skin begins to crawl. That's the old statement my mother used to say. I feel like my skin's crawling. So, and I thought that's the craziest thing, but I understand. They make your skin crawl. Hallelujah. I mean, you just think, I just got to get out of here, got to get away from here. I just, woo, can't handle this anymore. And what is the key element? Peace. You can't have peace without faith. Amen. You cannot. We could put peace and rest together. You cannot have peace without faith. So you need to make a note of that, and that we have to understand that the Lord wants us. He wants us, even in our training, to embrace the training, because you understand you're going to win the goal. Like somebody in the Olympics, you know, they don't win the Olympics the night they do the Olympics. They won the Olympics in the training. They embraced the training. They took on the training. And they were ready for where they went with it. Well, I mean, that's the same thing you and I have to do. See, the Israelites, they totally failed in faith. I mean, they just totally did. And they didn't enter God's peace. They never entered his rest. They never entered what he had prepared for them before the world even existed. He wasn't making it up for them at the moment. He was trying to give them something he'd had all along. He was trying to say, man, I've got this for you. I've had this forever. You know, he's saying, you know, hello, Sally. I've got this for you. This has always been there. This is waiting for you. It's got your name on it, Sally. And Sally's going way over here. And God's got it here. And Sally said, there's no way I can get that. There's just no way I can get that. And so what have you done? You have no peace about it. And it takes faith. You know, if God says I have it, bless God, I have it. And that's exactly what the Israelites should have done. He kept giving it to them and giving it. Go in. He never commented about the giants. They didn't matter to him. He never wanted them to even see them. He wanted them to see him and to trust him.
How can you tell if you are truly living in faith? The answer is rest. When we are not at peace, we are not trusting God. Genuine faith and rest can be experienced by anyone who desires it. In the 4-CD series, Genuine Faith Produces Rest, Sandra teaches how to enter this place of faith and make peace a reality in your life. When at peace in believing God is faithful to His Word, you'll have rest in knowing everything is going to be all right. Call to place your order or order online.
I mean, he just wants us to know that you and I have to begin to confess peace. Now, that means if I'm going to confess peace, I've got to say, okay, I'm not going to be irritable. Now, this is where y'all look real holy. So let's get this settled, okay? This was a real point. This was a real point. I didn't like it any more than you like it. Confess you are not going to be irritable. And I wanted to say, but you don't know. And then he said, confess you're not going to worry. I thought, whoa. Then confess you're not going to be stressed. I thought, over the hill, I'm stressed out. He said, start saying you are not going to be stressed. And then he said, I'm not going to be ruffled. I'm not going to be exasperated. I choose to live with the Prince of Peace. And I thought, oh, Lord, that's a mouthful. That's hard to do, Lord. He said, I didn't ask you to do it. I asked you to choose. I just gave you a nugget. Choice does not deal with emotions. Amen. Your will is not an emotional factor. I just gave you another point. I'll talk about that more in a minute. See, lack of peace makes me weak. Amen. Amen. And it also weakens my stamina. Yes. Psalms 34 says, seek peace, pursue it. Isaiah 30:15 says, in quietness and confidence will be your strength. So when I don't have any peace, I get worn out. I'm tired. I look like death warmed over. Y'all know how that goes, don't you? Hallelujah. If you have stamina in the midst of a battle, it means that you don't persist in the situation. You persist in maintaining your peace. Tell your neighbor, I'm winning. I refuse, no matter what happens, no matter how many times I crumble, thank God I've got enough sense to get back up. I refuse to lose. I am not going to lose to hell. I'm not. I don't care what you think. I don't care what it looks like to you. You keep watching. I'm coming back up. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I refuse to stay on the side of defeat. I refuse to talk about it. I'm a winner. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm a winner. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You remember James said, consider it all joy, my brethren, sistren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Don't waste time focusing on the circumstances. I mean, they'll get you for a minute. I mean, they get all of us. And I said, whoa, You know, and by that time, I just want to bop everybody I know, and then I get away from it. Oh, I hate I even said that. I shouldn't have even brought that up. I mean, dear God. And what I end up doing, pulling somebody in the corner saying, you know, I'm sorry. But thank God I don't mind saying I'm sorry. Amen. You are really bad news when you can't say I'm sorry. Right. So anyway, you got to remember God's with us. He's in us. And he has the answer to the question you don't even have enough sense to ask. Now, that's not the way he quite put it. But he has the answer that we don't know how to ask. The question we don't know how to ask. He already has the answer to it. And he's on our side. He can turn everything around. He says, give me your emotions. Give me your thoughts. Are y'all listening? And he says, your will, and take my peace in exchange. Give me your will. Trust me. I'll give you my peace. Now, here's the thing about your will. This is what I was going to tell you. This was a short one. It has no emotions of its own. Your will has no emotions of its own. So if your emotions are positive, great. If they're negative, ignore them. Your will is what matters. You have the power to choose, and don't ever let the devil or your flesh tell you you can't help it. That's a lie. Amen. Amen. Your will was designed to operate independent of your emotions. Amen. On your very worst day, you can choose to praise the Lord. Amen. On your very worst day, Amen. You can choose to praise the Lord. You can choose, I'm going to celebrate the Lord. I know he doesn't lie. I know he's right there with me. I know he's going to take care of me. I want the Prince of Peace. My situation, I'm putting it in capable hands. Hallelujah. And I'm going to choose to relax. Hallelujah. Amen. Bring me an ice cream. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I mean, God's on our side. Because Jesus can handle every single thing. Now, one of the greatest, biggest, this was a I knew it, but I just was surprised that the Lord knew it, I guess. But anyway, that he saw it like this. That at the present time, one of the greatest attacks against the church or community life or fellowship that we have is in the body is the lack of personal interaction. That has resulted from the proliferation of technology. Are you listening to me? You were created for person-to-person communication, both human and spiritual. You better be listening. These are nuggets that were directly spoken. Amen. Are you listening to me? Amen. Now, you know, this neurologist discovered a long time ago that human brain responds far more to spoken communication face-to-face than to written communication. That's a proven fact. No matter how much you like to do the, you know, want to write and just do everything on your little computer and not ever have to eyeball anybody. That's a chicken way out. I mean, it's one thing to tell somebody what you think and don't have to look at them in the eyeball. Or judge them and don't have to say a word to them and all you do is just close your computer and say, don't even let them know where it came from. I mean, what is that? Stupid. What is that? This world. And why do we not understand relationships? Because some of you just have a relationship with a computer. The only person you ever see is whoever shows up on the computer. And you just talk to them. And then you say, I know them. I talk to them every day. Oh, come on. Oh, my word. I'm slow, honey, but I'm not that slow. Now, it's been proven. We were made to react to people, to respond, to have a relationship with people. Why some marriages not? Well, you ought to go and sit in a restaurant and just sit there. They're sitting across the table from each other, talking to each other on the phone. Across the table. Don't even know how to look at anybody. No wonder we have a society that doesn't care. Shooting you down is no different than shooting you on a computer. No feelings involved whatsoever.
Amen. Amen.
No emotion. See a family sitting around. I'd hate to even ask how many of y'all ever sit down and have a meal together. It used to be the center of the family. Oh, we don't have time now. Oh, no, you have time to do whatever you want to do. The human brain is wired for interpersonal communication with your fellow human beings and the Lord. You hadn't been texting the Lord, have you?
Jesus! Help us, Lord! Come on now.
Another nugget I'm giving you. A direct nugget I'm giving you. There are two things that will extend your life. It shocked me. I told you this message shocked me. Two things that will extend your life. It's not healthy eating, even though you should. It's not clean air, even though you do better in it. It's not giving up smoking or drinking, even though you ought to. This is me telling you, okay? It's not me. All these things are good, but the two things that most need that contributes to a long life. Number one, face-to-face interaction with other people. Face-to-face. Oh, I could ask you all day long, you wouldn't give me these answers. This came directly from the Lord.
Amen.
Number two, possibly two, but at least one, spirit-to-spirit friendship or relationship. Now, notice I didn't say just relationship. I said spiritual relationship, where you talk about God, where you help each other with God. The epidemic of human disconnectedness is the root cause of all the division, the hatred, the anger, and violence in our present world. And all of it has come out a famine of inner peace in the souls of the world. It must not be so among his beloved disciples. He says the most effective form of evangelism today is telling your story. He says, I love to tell my story through your story. Just tell somebody. Because everybody's in some kind of hurting place, they need to know. I was there, and he brought me out. Amen. I had this, and he did this. The most effective thing you can do. Like I was talking to these young married couples up here this morning. The most effective thing you can do as a young married couple is have everybody that you know that are a young married couple wondering why you are making it.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And they're falling apart.
Amen.
And the answer is Jesus. In the center of your life. You've not pushed him out on the peripheral. You've brought him in. Your life is stabilized in him and through him. You see the value of him. You're built around Bible. And you stay with the Bible.
Do you know Jesus as the indwelling Prince of Peace? That is who he is. And we just never tap into that. But we, after listening to that message, are so made aware that he is our peace. He is our all in all. If you need us to stand with you and just hold your arms up in prayer, call our prayer line now. We would love to pray with you and encourage you, because that's why we're here. We're here for you. He loves you. He cares about you. There's not any situation that will face you that he's not there with you and going before you. And so therefore we have to learn to rest in him and trust in him. Go to our website at sandrakennedy.org. See all the things that we're offering and the product this month. It is there to bless you and to encourage you and to help you grow in the things of God.
Like being down and out. I don't like being in a pit. I don't like, you know, being around everybody who's so negative. So you have to constantly pull yourself up, because all of us have a tendency to go that way. But joy is the key to walking in victory.
This book is showing you how to take the Word of God, how to stand on it, how to get the results that He says belongs to you. And most people give up before they see the manifestation.
Been a partner since 2009, and I'm just so thankful for it. You got a partner, you got a partner, you got a partner, and just let Jesus do great things in your life, in your family's life. And it's-